Thanks very much. I'm going to start with, I guess, a confession. Regret. I wish I wore spandex today. I feel like it would have fit in a little better. So I'll tell you a quick story. There's a guy by the name of William Swenson who was in the United States Army, and he was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor for acts of valor and other things he did while in Afghanistan. It all happened on one day when he was escorting a group of Afghan elders for some peace negotiations, and their group was ambushed. And they were ambushed from three sides. And it was a bad day. And the good guys took on a lot of casualties. And Captain Swenson ran into live fire multiple times, both to rescue the wounded and pull out the fallen. He'd rescued one Marine who'd taken a bullet into the neck. And a medevac helicopter came to get him. And by sheer coincidence, that day, both the pilot and one of the medics had GoPro cameras on their helmets, and they captured the scene. You can see it on YouTube, it's amazing. And what you see is Captain Swenson escort and carry this wounded Marine. They put him in the helicopter, and right before the helicopter leaves, he bends down and gives him a kiss on the forehead. This is an act of love. That's all that can be explained at. And so I start asking myself the question, where do people like this come from? You know, in the military, they give medals to people who are willing to sacrifice themselves that others may gain. In business, we like to give bonuses to people who are willing to sacrifice others so that we may gain. Backwards. And so the original conclusion I came up with is they're just better people. And the reason we find so many of them in the military is because these better people are drawn to a life of service. But I was wrong. It's not the people, it's the environment. We are social animals, and we live in groups for our own security. As social animals, we respond to the environments we're in. You could take a good person and put them in a bad environment, and they're capable of doing bad things. Likewise, you can take a person that maybe the group's given up on, and you put them in a good environment, and they're capable of turning their lives around and becoming remarkable members and productive members of the group and of society. This is not an accident. It's because when we live in groups, our survival and our ability to thrive goes up. You heard all about the value of relationships. This is true. It means that we can fall asleep at night and trust that someone else will watch for danger. If we don't trust each other, it means we can't fall asleep at night. Bad system. Bad system. The problem with concepts like trust and cooperation is they're not instructions. I can't tell you to trust me and you will. You can't instruct people to work together, to cooperate, and they will. Cooperation means that I can turn my back and trust that someone else won't stab me. Cooperation means that I can ask for your help and trust that you'll get the work done and I don't have to double check it. Trust and cooperation are feelings. And they're feelings born directly out of the environment we're in. This goes back thousands and thousands of years. You can just imagine what life must have been like in the Paleolithic times, when Homo sapiens first started to show up. This was a time filled with danger, a time filled with all of these forces that were working very, very, very hard to kill us. Nothing personal, it's just the way it was. Whether it was bad weather, lack of resources, saber-toothed tiger, whatever. And so we evolved into these social animals where we lived and worked amongst people around whom we felt safe. And when we felt safe amongst our own, the natural human response to those conditions was to combine our talents, seize the opportunities, and face the dangers. When we do not feel safe amongst our own, the natural human response is cynicism, paranoia, mistrust, and self-interest. Let me give an example of what I mean. Nothing has changed in our modern day and age, by the way. Nothing. The world is still filled with danger, the ups and downs of an economy, the uncertainty of a stock market. Your competition that is sometimes trying to put you out of business, sometimes trying to kill you, but at the very minimum is trying to steal your business and frustrate your growth. We have no control of these forces. These forces are a constant. The only variable are the conditions inside the organization. And this is why we have leaders, because leaders create the conditions inside an organization. Whether it's just you and one other person, it doesn't matter. There's going to be conditions, and we're going to respond to those conditions. Here's what I mean. I was witness to a scene that played out in an airport. One of the passengers attempted to board the aircraft before their group number was called. I believe this is a felony. At least that's how the gate agent treated him. Step aside, sir. I haven't called your group yet. Step aside and wait for me to call your group, is exactly how she talked to him. And so I spoke up. I said, why do you have to talk to us that way? Why can't you talk to us like we're human beings? And she looked me in the eye and said, sir, if I don't follow the rules, I could get in trouble or lose my job. All she revealed to me is that she does not feel safe in her own organization. All she revealed to me is that her own leaders do not trust her. And guess who suffers? Customer and company. The reason we love flying Southwest Airlines is not because they have some magical formula to hire great people. It's because the people who work there feel safe amongst their own. It's because of the people who work there feel like their leaders trust them. And guess who benefits? The customer and the company. It is essential that you create a circle of safety if you want to have any success in the world, that the people with whom you work, whether they're your colleagues or whether they're your customers, feel safe working with you, that they develop this feeling of trust and cooperation with you. So if you have to create a circle of safety, it begs the question, how do you create a circle of safety? As it turns out, human bodies work exactly the same way as an organization. If we want to direct the behavior of people inside an organization, we know exactly what to do. Give them some sort of goal and offer them some sort of bonus. Hit the goal, get the bonus. And guess what everybody does? They work towards the goals that we set. We do with our children. You know, eat your vegetables, have dessert. Clean your room, get a gold star. Works perfectly well. It's exactly the same inside our bodies. Inside our bodies is a system of chemicals, a system of incentives designed to reward us to repeat behavior that is in our best interest. This has nothing to do with free will. Of course we have free will, but when we choose to do things that are in the interest of us or the group, our body rewards us so that we will repeat those behaviors. If you've ever had a feeling of happiness, joy, success, pride, achievement, status, friendship, love, all of these feelings can basically be boiled down to four chemicals inside our bodies. They are endorphins, dopamine, serotonin, and oxytocin. Edso. You all know endorphins. I hope you do. Endorphins have one purpose and one purpose only. It is to mask physical pain. That's what they do. You go for a run. You push your body a little harder than you're used to. You feel good. And so you keep going. And at the end of your exercise, at the end of your run, you feel amazing. And then about an hour later, you're in pain for damage you caused your muscles about an hour before. It's because the endorphins ran out. The caveman reason for endorphins is much more practical. We're not the strongest animal, we are not the fastest animal, and yet we have to eat. As it turns out, we are made for endurance. We can go hunting and gathering and tracking for hours and hours and hours and miles and miles and miles, and we don't give up simply because we're tired. We don't give up simply because we're injured or we have to carry something heavy back to the tribe. We persist because it feels good. In our modern day and age, we don't really need endorphins much for survival anymore. Heavy exercise is the main way we get it. There are some other fun ways to get endorphins. I'm talking about laughing. I don't know what you're thinking about. The reason laughing feels good is because we're actually convulsing our internal organs, and endorphins are released to mask that physical pain, which is why it feels good. We've all had the experience where you laugh so hard that you say, stop, stop, it hurts. It's because the endorphins have run out. Dopamine. Dopamine is responsible for the feeling you get when you find something you're looking for or you accomplish something you set out to accomplish. You know that fantastic feeling you get when you cross something off your to-do list? That sort of, oh, that's because of dopamine, right? I was running some errands back home in New York, and I had my to-do list written on the back of an envelope or whatever it was, and I walked past a store, and I remembered I had to run an errand in that store, but I had forgotten to write it on my list. Walking past the store reminded me. And so I went into the store, completed my errand, came out, wrote it on the list, and crossed it out. I wanted the feeling of accomplishment. Dopamine is responsible for the feeling you get when you hit a target, whether it's a weight target or some sort of accomplishment or some sort of revenue target. Yes! When you complete the mission. Yes! When you win the game, we did it! That amazing sense of accomplishment comes from dopamine. Also, when you find something you're looking for. Here it is! It's why we love shopping. It's why we love eBay. It's why we love Google. You type something in, nothing comes up. You type something in, nothing comes up. You type something in, there it is. That feeling, that's dopamine. Now, the caveman reason for dopamine is more practical and once again boils down to food. We actually get hits of dopamine when we eat. It's why we enjoy eating. We do not eat intellectually. Nobody says, hey, let's get lunch, otherwise our organs will fail and we'll die. That is the reason you need lunch, by the way. We like eating, we enjoy eating, so what do? We repeat the behavior that gets us food. We go looking for food, right? As you can just imagine, these early Homo sapiens wandering across the savannas of the plains, and in the distance they saw an apple tree or a gazelle. That sounded good. They get an apple tree or gazelle, they see a gazelle, and they see it, they say, that's the thing we want. Get it. And so what dopamine allows us to do and helps us do is stay clear of distractions and focus on the thing we want. And we start making steps towards that apple tree, and as we get a little closer, the apple tree gets a little bigger, we get another shot of dopamine, and we feel like we're making progress. As we get a little closer, a little closer, a little closer, until we finally get to the tree, we're like, yes! Did it! Huge surge of dopamine, huge sense of accomplishment. We are very, very visual animals. We have to be able to see the thing we're after for this incentive system to work. This is why we are often told you have to write down your goals. If you don't write down your goals, you won't achieve them. There is some biological truth to this. We are no good with the abstract or the amorphous. You will get a bonus if you accomplish more. How much more, you ask? More. It's unnerving. Tell me the target, tell me the number you want me to reach, and I'm all about it. And I will set my tasks and set my sights on that target, and I'll do what I have to do to get it. And every time I feel like I'm making progress, it incentivizes me to keep going and going towards that target, right? Metrics are very important, don't get me wrong. The problem is we have to know the destination. We have to know the thing we're after. Can you imagine running a race with no mile markers in it? We put mile markers because it helps us feel like we're making progress. That's why they're there. The metrics are very important. The problem is if there's no finish line, you just keep running and running and running, and you feel like you're making progress, but at some point in your career, you feel, why is this worth it? Yeah, I've made a lot of money, and I've advanced my career. I can count all the mile markers, I can count all the metrics, but I don't feel like I've accomplished anything. This is the difference between a goal and a vision. A goal is something that's fixed in time, easily measured, and we know exactly where it is, 26.2 miles. And all you have to do is count the metrics, count the mile markers until you get there. Easy. A vision is having a crystal clear sense of what a future looks like for you, but no sense of how far away it is. And every goal actually serves as a milestone towards the vision. If you do not have a vision, eventually the goals start to get tiring each time you achieve them, and they start to lose their value. Oh good, another marathon. Okay, right? Most of the visions that we articulate are amorphous. They are abstract, they are useless. To be the biggest, to be the fastest growing, to be the most respected. Respected by whom? Your mom? How do you know when you get there? How are you basing biggest? Is it revenues? Is it profit? Is it how many people you've sold to? Is it square footage of your office? Is it number of employees? What does biggest mean? And what does it mean when you get there? You close the doors? I've done it! I'm now the biggest! We can shut down. This is the difference between a goal and a vision. You have to have a sense of vision, where you're going, what all of this is for. That's what purpose means. Martin Luther King, he understood vision. I have a dream, he said, that one day little black children will hold hands on the playground with little white children. You can see that. You can imagine in your mind's eye. That's why they call it vision, by the way, because you can see it. And if that's the kind of world that inspires you, if that's the kind of world that you want to raise your children in, you set your sights on that vision, and every milestone you pass makes you feel like you're making progress to that distant land. And for all intents and purposes, you will never get there, but you will die trying. That's what gives our lives purpose. Dopamine is a remarkable chemical. It is the reason we get anything done. It's what makes us achievement machines. However, it comes with a warning. If left unbalanced, dopamine can be highly, highly, highly addictive. Here are some other things that release dopamine. Alcohol, nicotine, gambling, your cell phone. Think about how gambling works. We know what the apple tree in the distance looks like. It's 3 sevens, it is crystal clear. And we know exactly what happens when we hit 3 sevens, we get rich. And so what do? We perform a behavior that takes us to the thing that we want, the thing that we can see. We put a coin in the machine and we pull the handle. And we get 1 seven. Nearly there, keep going. And so we put another coin in the machine and we pull the handle. And now you get the bottom of 1 seven and the top of another one. Keep going. And you put another coin in the machine. And now you get that feeling where you have 2 sevens and half a seven. You're like, oh, the near miss. Except it's not you versus yourself. It's not you versus your competition. It's not you versus nature. It's you versus casino. And it is a rigged game. It is literally tricking our internal reward system to get us to repeat behavior that is not in our best interest. If you got 0 sevens, if you got 0 indication of progress, you would either think the machine is broken, or you would go looking for another machine because this machine is no fun. Remember, dopamine feels good. Our cell phones are the same. Yes, we all hate all the email we get. What we love is the bing, the buzz, the flash, and the beep. Oh. How else can you explain if it's not addiction? When you're feeling a little bit down or depressed, you send out 10 texts hoping to get one back. How else can you explain how you feel the need to walk from room to room in your own home, carrying your phone wherever you go? How else can you explain that when you have to go to the bathroom, you will hold it in to find your phone? That is not in your best interests. How else can you explain when you're driving in your car and your phone goes buzzer beep, you have to answer it now, 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 now. You can't wait 10 or 15 minutes. And when you do, it says, do you want to have dinner next Thursday? And you have to reply, now, 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 now. You can't wait 10 or 15 minutes. This is called addiction. And like all addiction, in time, you will waste resources, you will waste time, and you will destroy relationships. in an unbalanced organization, in an unhealthy organization, where the primary means by which we reward behavior is a dopamine-driven reward system. Hit the goal, get the bonus, hit the goal, get the bonus, hit the goal, get the bonus. If all we have are the metrics, if all we have are weight goals or numbers, and that's the only thing we have in our lives, in time, you will become addicted to making the numbers. Unhealthy organizations, the people inside literally become addicted to performance. It's what happened in many of our large investment banks. The people there literally are addicted to performance, addicted to making the numbers. It's what happens to some individual athletes. They're so driven by winning, they will cheat, they will stab each other in the back. It doesn't matter if they have to beg, borrow, and steal so they can get their hit of dopamine and feel that amazing surge of, I did it. That's why the other two chemicals exist. These are selfish chemicals. Go exercise, go achieve your goals, and you will feel fine. But they come in hits, and the feelings do not last. If you got an endorphin rush this morning, that feeling is gone. That's why you have to exercise again. Remember, it's about food, it's about repetitive behavior. That goal that you hit a year ago, that amazing sense of accomplishment that you had, that feeling is gone. That's why you have to set another goal. Remember, it's about repetitive behavior. But you don't need anybody's help to get those feelings. And they do not last. That's why the other two chemicals exist. These are the selfless chemicals. These are the chemicals of trust and cooperation. These are the chemicals that make us human. They are the chemicals of the circle of safety. The first one is called serotonin. It is the feeling of pride. It's the feeling of status. There are many healthy ways to get serotonin. One is public recognition. That's why events like this are very important. Because I'm sure at some point throughout the event, somebody's name will be called out for some sort of accomplishment. Can we all give Stacey a round of applause for the amazing thing? It's just a hypothetical. But I'm sure all the Stacey's in the audience are feeling pretty damn good right now. Because when we hear our names called out in a public forum, we are social animals, we are tribal animals, especially for something we've accomplished, when we are recognized for something that we did for the group, we feel valued and valuable. The serotonin starts to flow. This is why we have commencement. Think about it. What does it take to graduate college? Technically, all you need to do is pay your bills, fulfill your minimum requirements, and collect enough credits. That's technically all you need to do. They could just send you an email that says, congratulations, you graduated college. Enclosed, please find a PDF of your diploma. P.S. Magna Cum Laude. The accomplishment would be exactly the same. It just wouldn't feel as good. So instead what we do is we have a big event called commencement, where we invite our friends and our families and our teachers, all of those who have sacrificed for us so we may achieve this thing. It is simply a big public recognition ceremony. And it seems like a big waste of money, but it's not. Not for social animals. And that young college graduate hears her name called out in a public forum. She comes up on the stage to receive her diploma. The serotonin starts to flow, and she feels her status rise in the tribe, and she feels proud. And she walks across that stage, and at the moment she grabs that diploma, she gets a huge surge of serotonin. She feels amazing. Her self-confidence rises. Serotonin is very closely tied to self-confidence. She feels fantastic. And here is the best part. At that exact moment, her parents sitting in the audience also get a surge of serotonin, and they also feel proud. What serotonin is attempting to do is reinforce the relationship between parent and child, leader and follower, coach and player, trainer and trainee. That's what it's attempting to do. Reinforce the relationship between those who have sacrificed for me and those who are the recipient of that sacrifice. Sure, you can incentivize people to work harder and give you more, but eventually that system runs out because eventually they'll either take a better offer somewhere else, or eventually it gets expensive, or eventually, even though they're earning tons, they have no sense of purpose and it just doesn't feel good anymore. And so they actually becomes less effective. Where when we feel that someone believes in us, that someone has our back, that someone wants to see us achieve our greatest potential. If somebody says to us, I believe in you, I got your back. I know you're capable of more. And I'm going to help you achieve that. When we believe it and we feel it, our sense of loyalty and love towards those people goes up. We will work for them with blood and sweat and tears to prove to them that their belief in us, that their sacrifice in us was worth it. We work hard because we want to make them proud. That is biologically accurate. We are constantly evaluating the words and actions of everybody, both individuals and organizations, trying to assess if they are selfish or selfless. It's in our interest. Remember, almost all human behavior is governed by our desire to feel safe. Can you imagine if we gave an award to somebody? Let's say they are the top performer in the entire organization. They are ranked number one. And we have a big award ceremony. We give them an award for being the top performer. And they come up to receive their award, and they get to give a little speech, and they say, I deserve this. I am the best. You are very lucky to have me. Now, empirically, every single one of those statements is true. They are the best, they do deserve it, and we are lucky to have them. If they would actually say those words, however, we would hate them. You would think intellectually it would be a good idea to align your career with the top performing person in the organization, but we wouldn't. Because all of our behavior is governed by our desire to feel safe, and we would assess them as selfishly driven, and we would more likely align ourselves with an average performer that we trust than a top performer that we can't trust. So usually what happens when people accept an award is they say, thank you. I don't deserve this. I couldn't have done it without my team, or my spouse, or my partner, or my friend. And only when there is a genuine expression of gratitude and humility, humility meaning that I recognize that all of my personal accomplishments are conditional on the love and support of those around me. I don't think it is about me. You can lie, but eventually people will figure it out. It has to be a genuine expression of gratitude and humility. Then our team and our partners sit in the audience and they go, we love. And we share in a sense of pride and continue to work hard for each other. Serotonin is the leadership chemical. I call it the leadership chemical simply as a matter of history. For 40 of the 50,000 years that we lived on this planet Earth, we lived in populations that were rarely bigger than about 150 people. This presents a practical problem. What it means is that when someone brings food back to the tribe and dumps it on the ground, we all rush in to eat. If you're lucky enough to be built like a football player, you can shove your way to the front of the line. If you're the artist of the family, you get an elbow in the face. This is a bad system, because what it means is that if you punch me in the face this afternoon, I'm probably not going to wake you and alert you to danger tonight. Bad system. And so we evolved into hierarchical animals. We're constantly assessing and judging each other. Who's alpha in the system? Sometimes it's a formal system. We have rank very often in companies and organizations. We know who's more senior than us. But it's also informal. We're constantly assessing and judging each other based on all kinds of informal characteristics and settings. And we judge somebody as alpha to us. We voluntarily step back and allow our alphas to eat first. Alphas get first choice of meat and first choice of mate. Alphas are given preferential treatment. And though I may not get to eat first, I will be guaranteed to get food, and I don't get an elbow in the face. Good system. Nothing has changed in our modern day. Absolutely nothing. There is not a single person in this room, absolutely zero, who is bothered by the fact that somebody more senior than you in the organization makes a higher salary than you. Doesn't bother us at all. You may think they're completely ineffective, but the fact that they're more senior and they make more money doesn't bother anybody. It bothers no one that someone more senior gets a better parking space or a bigger office. It's good to be the king. It's good to be the queen. That's why no one has ever turned down a promotion. No one has ever tried to turn down their raise and status because it comes with advantages. You make more money. People call you sir and ma'am. They bring you coffee and tea without you asking. They hold doors open for you. You get upgrades. It's awesome. And that's why guys in bars like to do this to show that they're higher status, like they're trying to fake it. I don't know what that means. Because it's attractive, supposedly. However, all of the perks you get from raising your status, from being a leader, from having a leadership position, they do not come for free. As a Marine Corps general explained to me, the cost of leadership is self-interest. You see, the group doesn't give you all of those perks and advantages for nothing. There's an expectation. You see, when danger threatens the tribe, the group expect that the person who's actually better fed, who's actually stronger, who's actually smarter, who actually has more confidence from all of the love and adoration that we give you, we expect that the stronger, better fed, more confident person will rush towards the danger to protect us. That's why we gave you first choice of mate, because you might die first and we want to keep your genes in the gene pool. We're not stupid. Leadership is a choice. That's what it is. Leadership means that you would be willing to sacrifice your interests for the life of another human being. That's what it is. It is not a position, it is a responsibility. It's not about being in charge, it's about taking care of those in your charge. I know many people who sit at the highest levels of organizations who are not leaders. They have authority, and we do as they tell us because they have authority over us, but we would not follow them. And yet I know many people who sit at the lower levels of organizations that have no authority, and yet they've made a choice. A choice to look after the person to the left of them, and a choice to look after the person to the right of them. And we would follow them anywhere. In the United States Marine Corps, there's a strange thing that happens. I sat down with the same Marine Corps general and I asked him the question, what makes the Marines so good at what they do? And he replied simply, officers eat last. And if you go to any Marine chow hall anywhere in the world, you will see that when it's time to eat, they line up rank order. The most junior Marine eats first, the most senior Marine eats last. Now, if the general wanted to go take his food first, no one would question it, no one would have a problem. In fact, we'd be totally fine with it. He is the general, after all. Except the Marines view leadership not as a rank, but as a responsibility. And one of the strange ways it shows up is when they eat. And just like a parent feeds their child before they feed themselves, so too does a leader take care of their people before they take care of themselves. No order was given to do this. It's not in any rule book. It's simply because they understand the responsibility of leadership, taking care of the people in your charge. True story. There's a group of Marines who were deployed, and it came time to eat, and as is their habit, the officer ate last. Except on this particular day, there was no food left for the officer, and he went hungry. And they went back out into the field, and one by one, each of his men brought him some of their food. Because this is the trick to great leadership. The officers never go hungry. When our people believe that we would sacrifice our interests for their lives, we will reward them with our love and our loyalty, and we will offer our blood and sweat and tears to see that your vision comes to life. If we believe, however, that you would sacrifice our lives for your interests, we reward you with paranoia, cynicism, mistrust, and self-interest, and we will spend more time trying to protect ourselves from you than helping you. If you work in an organization where it is standard practice for people to send a CYA email after every decision that's made, that is a sign that people are taking time and energy out of their day, away from advancing the mission, away from advancing the organization, away from helping each other in order to protect themselves from their own leaders. That's what that is. If you work in an organization where it is standard practice for people to keep a folder of all the good things they've ever done, just in case they need it, that is a sign that people are taking time and energy out of their day, away from helping each other, away from advancing the organization. They are spending their time and their energy to protect themselves from you. That's what that is. The reason so many of us have a visceral contempt for some of the banking CEOs and their disproportionate salaries and bonuses has nothing to do with the money. It has to do with the fact that they have violated the very anthropological definition of what a leader is. We know that they allowed their people to be sacrificed so they could keep their bonuses and salaries. Or worse, they sacrificed their people so they could keep their bonuses and salaries. This is what we find so morally reprehensible. It's not the money. What if I told you that we're going to give a $150 million bonus to Nelson Mandela? Does anybody have a problem with that? Nope. Did you know that when you win the Nobel Peace Prize, they give you $1.5 million in cash, no strings attached? If you want, you can go buy a fleet of Ferraris. Does anybody here have a problem with a Nobel Peace Prize winner being given $1.5 million of free money? Nope. We are perfectly comfortable with our alphas being given all of the perks and advantages of their position if we know that they would be willing to sacrifice their interests to take care of us. That's the deal. Leadership is not for everyone. We don't call you leader simply because you're at the top. We call you leader because you chose to go first. First into the unknown, first to take the risk, first to rush towards danger to take care of others. This is why we call you leader. And not everyone is cut out for leadership, because the risks are real. If you stand up against injustice, you're the one that could have your head chopped off. If you want to take care of your people, you're the one who could get in trouble. Or your numbers could be sacrificed in the short term. That's what leadership is. One of the problems with leadership is it's just like exercise. There is no good way to measure how valuable it is on a daily basis. You go to the gym, you come home, you look in the mirror, and you will see nothing. And you go to the gym the next day, and you come back, and you look in the mirror, and you will see nothing. Worse, you're in pain. And so empirically, we see that there is no value from the effort that I'm spending, and I'm hurting, and so we quit. It's easy to quit. Leadership is exactly the same. You will see no benefit from the effort that you invest in the short term. But we all know what a well-led organization looks like. It's easy to see it over the long term. The problem is I don't know how long it takes. Hey, Simon, how long does it take for leadership to work? I don't know. How long does it take before you'll see results from exercise? I know it takes more than a week. I know that. But I know that if you see no results in a year, you're probably doing something wrong. But I don't know when it happens. In fact, just like exercise, people sometimes start to notice the benefits of your efforts before you do. Have you been working out? I have, actually. I didn't even notice that my culture was getting better. Nobody even recognized it before. And it starts to get easier. The pain goes away. The weight gets lighter. The exercises get easier. You start to enjoy it more. You gain a momentum. And you get better at it, and better at it, and better at it. Leadership, like exercise, like parenting, is an act of faith. You do the things because they are the right things to do, even though you will not see a demonstrable, measurable impact on a daily basis. But you will see it over time without a question. And just like exercise, sometimes the metrics go down in the short term. Sometimes the stress goes up in the short term. There is sometimes pain that goes along with trying to do these right things. Let me tell you a quick story. There's a company in St. Louis called Barry Waymiller. They're about a $2 billion company, about 8,000 employees. So it's not a small company. And it came 2008 hit, and they were hit very hard by the recession. And they lost 30% of their orders overnight. And so the board got together and said, we need to have layoffs. And the CEO, Bob Chapman, said, absolutely not. You see, Bob doesn't believe in head counts. Bob believes in heart counts. And it's very hard to reduce a heart count. And so instead what they did is they implemented a furlough program where every single employee from CEO to secretary had to take 4 weeks of unpaid vacation. They didn't have to take it consecutively, and they could take it whenever they wanted. And morale went up. And it was how Bob announced the program that mattered so much. He said it's better that we should all suffer a little than any of us should have to suffer a lot. And the loyalty and love that his people devoted to him and to each other skyrocketed. And behaviors started to show up that were not in the program that they didn't even predict. People who could afford it more started trading with people who could afford it less. So some people took 5 weeks and then somebody else only had to take 3 weeks. This is what happens in well-led organizations. Leadership doesn't mean you're of the highest rank. Leadership means that you have chosen to take care of those in your group. There's an old Arab saying that says 1,000 enemies outside the tent is better than 1 enemy inside the tent. You're responsible for the people you work with. You're responsible for your family. You're responsible for your clients. You're responsible for those who you have raised your hand and said, I will take care of you. And when they believe you, they will be your biggest champions. They will help you through thick and thin. They will support you. They will stick with you. They will give you their blood and sweat and tears to see that your vision comes to life. Because that's what you've been doing for them. Leadership is a choice. It is a practice. It is a daily practice of putting the interests of others sometimes before your own. You're driving to work. Somebody wants into your lane. What do? Do you pull your car up or pull your car back? That's an act of leadership right there. I know. You're going to have to get to work one car length late. I know. Maybe they're late. Maybe they have a big job interview. Maybe this is the day that they're going to put their life back together and they got in the wrong lane, or they're running late and they're trying to cut the line. I know. Or maybe they're just an ass. I don't know. But when did you become the sheriff? That's called leadership. Leadership is when you're standing in the elevator, the door, and you're running late for a meeting, and the doors are closing, and someone is running towards the elevator, and you go like this. We've all done it. I watched a woman at that very moment look for her lipstick, you know? Like I didn't see it. I think it was me that was running. It was me that was running. Leadership is when you go like this. And when you walk into the meeting a little late and everybody says, where were you? You say, I was doing something for someone. Leadership is when you ask someone how they're doing and you actually care about the answer. That's what leadership is. And sometimes these little distractions, our businesses and the numbers, get in the way of taking care of each other and taking care of people. Can I show you something? Can I borrow one of your phones? Let me show you something. Thanks. Okay, watch this. What if I were to hold my phone while I'm speaking to you? It's not buzzing. It's not beeping. I'm simply holding it. Do you think that you're the most important thing to me right now? No, you do not. And this is an artificial environment. So imagine when you're walking down the street or you're at the office or you're talking to a customer or you're talking to anybody you care about, a family member, and they say, hey, can I ask you a question? You go, sure, what's on your mind? They don't think that you think they're the most important thing in the world right now. And so you go like this. Sure, what's on your mind? You hide it. You take it out of the way. And if you don't have a pocket, I do this. I go put it on a side and I come back and go, yeah, what's on your mind? And when we show up to meetings, we show up for dinner, and we put our phones on the table, what we've announced is, you're not the most important to people to me right now. And putting it upside down is not more polite. My favorite one is this one. It rings and they go, I'm not gonna answer it. You're so magnanimous. Thank you. When you're with, in the company of others, especially people you care about, put it away, turn it off, everybody hand their phone one to the left. Get rid of it. Because what it communicates is, I actually care about you. And that opportunity to build that relationship now gets seeded. And like exercise, doing it once does nothing. Doing it twice does nothing. Do it every single time you spend time with the people you care about. Watch what happens. Mark my words. They will learn to trust you, and you will earn their trust. None of you should be having lunch with each other with your phones out. The value of these events is not the yahoo standing on the stage. The value of these events is you. There's not a single thing that you will see here today that you couldn't see online. There's not a single thing that you will see here today that we couldn't just put on a screen, you sit at your computer, and you watch what happens. Absolutely nothing. However, the one thing that we cannot recreate is this. The person to the left, the person to the right. And so in the breaks, get to know each other, talk to people, because I can promise you when your business is struggling, when you're having a hard time, when you're not sure you got it, you will call someone you met who knows what you're going through. And you will say, I'm hurting. And they'll say, I know how you feel. That's called being human. The fourth chemical, oxytocin, is everyone's favorite chemical. It is the feeling of love. It is the feeling of friendship. It's all the unicorns and rainbows, all the mushy, fuzzy things. It's because of oxytocin that we love spending time with our friends. We just love the company of our friends. You go to the movies, you're sitting in the dark, you don't talk to anybody, and yet you'd rather do that with someone than alone. We just like the company of our friends. It's because oxytocin makes us feel safe. That's what it does, right? That's why when you go to the movies, you leave an empty seat next to strangers, because strangers are scary. Can you imagine going to the movies with a friend and you go into an empty row and there's only one other couple sitting in there and you go all the way in and you sit right next to them and they're gonna look at you and be like, you wanna move over, bud? Or you go to the movie with your friend, it's an empty row, they sit down and you sit one seat away and they're gonna look at you and be like, what's your problem? It's because we like to sit next to people that we trust, that we love, that we care about. So if there's danger to the left and I'm looking right, they'll let me know. There are many healthy ways to get oxytocin. One is this magical thing. It's called human touch. This is why children are always touching us, and it's very important to hug your children. It's because it makes them feel safe. What do you do when someone's having a hard time? What do you do when someone's hurting? You go, don't worry, don't worry. You will get through us. Don't worry. We do not go, don't worry. You'll be fine. Kind of weird. We touch. Can you imagine signing a deal with someone? You know, I'm so excited to work with you. And they go, so am I, but I'm not going to shake your hand. And you go, no, but I'm really excited to do business with you. They go, I am too. I agree to all the terms. Let's get this deal signed. You think business is about terms and conditions and agreements. No, it's not. It's human beings looking for other human beings around whom they feel safe. That's what business is. And someone's refusal to shake your hand means one of two things will happen. You'll either walk away from the deal or you'll go into the deal with doubt. That is why we're perfectly happy to do a handshake deal without a contract, but we won't sign a contract without a handshake. Human touch. Human touch, right? There are other ways to get oxytocin. Another one is acts of kindness and acts of generosity. An act of kindness or generosity is defined as giving of your time and energy with no expectation of anything in return. Sorry, money doesn't count. I can prove it. What if I told you that before I came out here, I went online and I gave $500 to charity? What would you think of me? You'd be like, good for you. But what if I told you that last weekend, I went and gave up my Saturday and I went and painted schools in the inner city? Then what would you think of me? You'd be like, nice, cool, right? Exactly, right? The value of my labor is worth a lot less than $500. $500 could pay many more people to paint many more schools. But as human beings, we put a premium on those who are willing to give away a non-redeemable commodity. Time and energy. You spend money, you make money, you waste money, you make more money. Big deal. Time and energy, once it's gone, you never get it back. We have all sat in meetings and thought to ourselves, I will never get this time back. Some of you are sitting here right now thinking, I will never get this time back. You won't. So when someone gives us their time and energy, when somebody says to us, I believe in you, I got your back, we feel it. We feel it. Email doesn't work either. Email is about dopamine. It's like, oh, I got through all my dopamine. I mean, I got through, yeah, it's so true. So true. You get through all your emails like, oh, whew, finish the day. But what about the people on the receiving end? What if I came to your house and you made me an amazing dinner, and the next day I sent you an email telling you what a wonderful time I had and what a wonderful host you are? Or 3 days later, you get a handwritten note from me with the exact same words that are in the email. Which one makes you feel better? Handwritten note. Same words, same intention, same circumstances. The difference is you know it took me a little extra time and a little extra energy and you felt it. That's why sometimes when we get signed letters, we go, because we want to see if the signature's real. We want to see if they actually took the time and energy to sign it. Because it actually feels good if it does. I had a bit of a debate with a company. I accused them of not caring about their people. And they go like, well, we do. I'm like, no, you don't. I'm like, yeah, we do. No, we don't. I said, I bet you sent out some online survey to find out that they love their jobs. They did. I said, okay, riddle me this. What if you send an email to someone? What if a father sends an email to his son? Dear son, your mother and I care that you feel like you're a valuable member of this family. Please tell us candidly what you think we can do better. Because we love you. Love Dad. Or he walks into his room, he sits on the bed, he says, son, your mom and I really care that you feel like you're a valuable member of this family. Please tell me candidly what you think we could do better because we love you. The words are the same, the circumstance is the same, the intent is the same. The difference is in only one of those examples does he believe you actually care. That's what we're talking about here. The sacrifice of time and energy. I know it's hard, and I know you don't have unlimited amounts of it. That's why it's incredibly valuable. To stay late and show someone how it's done. To give someone the opportunity to try and fail, and you say, good fall, try again. To tell someone there's nothing you can break that I can't help fix. This is where relationships happen. Love, care, sacrifice. You know another thing that releases oxytocin? Shared hardship. That's why when we go through tough times with others, when everything goes wrong, when we have a death in the family, what does it do? It makes everybody come together. Look what happens after national tragedies. The people come together. We come together. And it's the leader who says, don't worry guys, we'll get through this. We will take care of each other. Acts of kindness, acts of generosity, with no expectation of anything in return. I was walking down the streets of New York, totally true story. Guy in front of me, his backpack opened and a bunch of paper fell out. I bent down, gathered up the papers, handed it back to him, pointed out that his backpack had opened. Small act of kindness, small act of generosity, I got a shot of oxytocin. It actually feels really good when we do something nice for someone, right? He turns around to me and goes, thank you. It feels really good when somebody does something nice for us. In other words, you get a shot of oxytocin when somebody does something nice for us with no expectation of anything in return. We've all had the experience where somebody does something nice and then they go, and you're like, oh, ruined it. You weren't doing it for me, you were doing it for the money. And all of a sudden, the feeling of goodwill literally just goes poof. That wasn't the case this day. On this day, I felt good for doing something small for him. He felt good for having somebody do something for him too. I get to the end of the block. This is a totally true story. I get to the end of the block. I'm waiting to cross the street, and a total stranger standing in front of me turns around and says to me, I saw what you did back there. That was really cool. As it turns out, witnessing an act of kindness or generosity actually releases oxytocin. And the more oxytocin we have in our bodies, the more generous we become. I guarantee you that guy did something nice for somebody that day simply because he saw me do something nice for someone. This is the biology of pay it forwards. The reason it feels so good when we do something for others and when somebody does something nice for us is because it's the human body's attempt. It's trying desperately to get us to look after each other. That's what's happening. Acts of kindness, acts of generosity with no expectation of anything in return. If you say that you care about someone's feelings and you're running late for a meeting, you go, "How you doing? Not good? I'll have to get with you later." If you're gonna ask the question, "How are you doing?" and they say not good, I hate to break it to you, you were standing there and you were listening. And if you're worrying about the meeting, you're not listening. People can feel it. We're highly attuned to this stuff. As human animals, we're highly, highly, highly attuned as to whether people are considerate of us or not, whether they care about us or not, whether they're being honest with us or not, because our survival depends on it. Leadership is a choice. That's all it is. It is a daily practice. It is hard. Sometimes it is lonely. Sometimes it is thankless. You put yourself at real risk. You will give up your time and you will give up your energy and you will be tired if you choose to be a leader. So why would anyone want to do it? I ask the same question about anybody who wants to be a parent. Why would you want to do that? It comes at great personal sacrifice. You have to buy a car you didn't want. I don't know of any teenager that has a poster of a Honda Odyssey on their wall. You didn't get the car that was on your wall. You got a Honda Odyssey. Your vacations change. You have a lot less time for yourself. You have a lot less money for yourself. It's frustrating. You're pulled in many different directions. It is stressful. Why anyone would want to have children is beyond me. And people say, "Oh, I'd love to have children." No. Having children is the fun part. Do you want to raise a child for 18 years is a different conversation. Do you want to be a leader? That's fun. Look how much I did. Look at my seniority. No. Do you want to sacrifice to take care of those that you claim you care about? That is a different conversation. And the reason we choose to become a leader is the exact same reason we choose to become a parent. It's because when we see our 5-year-old share his apple with our 4-year-old, it's when we get a report back from school, what a nice kid she is. It's when we go to the school play and we see her perform. Great timing. It's when they get their first girlfriend or boyfriend. It's when they graduate. It's when they get their first job and they get their first promotion. And we sit in the audience and we feel so proud. And all of a sudden we realize that the sacrifice was worth it. That's why we become leaders. If you're going to commit yourselves to help others be healthy, if you're going to commit yourselves to help others be successful, to find joy in their lives, to find love in their lives, it's really hard work. It's really hard work. Sometimes it's thankless. Sometimes it's exhausting. And you will need each other because you cannot do it alone. But if you choose that journey, the times where they come back to you and say, "Thank you. I couldn't have done it without you. Thank you for believing in me. Thank you for taking a risk on me." All the sacrifice, all the hardship, it's all worth it.